so delighted to be here. I saw those hands go up. And you know what? I do know, too, it may be true. There may be some of those hands that did not go up, that is not being paid fairly, and you don't know it. I want to tell you my story and what happened to me and why it's so important that we all have to stick together, including you fellows. We need you on our bandwagon because it also will affect you in your life, because if the women and minorities are not paid fairly, it doesn't only affect that individual, it affects their families, the community, the state in which they live, and our nation. I believe that the equal pay for equal work and women and minorities being compensated for what they've earned and under the law have the right to have, it will affect their families, their neighbors, and everybody. The president said when he signed the Lilly Ledbetter bill that it's a family affair. It benefits the families by a better education, better housing, or maybe they can own their own home, better food, better clothing, and it's just a better life for everybody involved. But I started to work for Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company in 1979. Prior to that, I was a district manager for H&R Block, managed 14 locations in a large area in Alabama. Before that, I was at Jacksonville State University, assistant to the financial aid director, spending money on those students, which my husband said spending money was one of my best talents. So I think we all women are pretty good at that. But if you get past my southern accent, as one of the ladies said last evening, I do have a story. It gets to the heart of, I think, every family across the country. Because this is not just Lilly Ledbetter. It's each and every one of you. If it's not you, it'll be someone in your family, your neighbor, or someone you've known. It touches all of us. Early on in my struggles, the lawyers thought that this would die down after the verdict came out and the media jumped on it immediately. But you know what? It struck and was in the hearts and souls of so many families across this country until it did not go away. They said, you know, the first calamity or the first big thing that happens and the news media jumps on it, your story will die. My story did not die. And the reason being, we've had those calamities. We've had, for example, the airplane that went into the river in New York. That only cut a program that I was participating in to a half an hour instead of an hour, but my story still remained. But it will stay because this is so necessary, and I am so hopeful and prayerful that the governor will sign this bill, 793, into law, because you people need it in California. And if he doesn't sign it this time, it needs to be passed again and get back to maybe the next governor. But it must be passed to protect all the people in California. But in my case, then, when I hired him with Goodyear in 1979, I went to work as a supervisor, managing people in the production area in the factory. Now, I thought at the time I was being a trailblazer because there were very, very few women in that factory. There were very few women. I asked around and started asking about the history. Very few women had ever made it longer than 5 or 6 years in that job. So I was there for 19 years. I went in one night and somebody had left me a note in my box at work showing my name in 3 men. The men were making anywhere from 35% to 40% lower base pay than I was. Now, being a first line manager at Goodyear, we were not union, but we got paid overtime. We got paid time and height, double time, triple time, depending on the amount of hours and the certain circumstances that we were working. Needless to say, all of the first line managers were required to work a lot of overtime because when my here on my opposite shift had a heart attack, for example, I worked 2 straight months, 12-hour shifts every night without a night off. When he wanted vacation or his son played Little League, I worked for him. I was a requirement of the job. So I have a lot of overtime hours clocked up through the years. I lost a lot of money that way because they take your base pay divided by 173 hours for the month, and then your base pay is calculated with the time and height and the other hours of overtime. And then my composure sort of went flat when I first saw that note and it hit me. I had suspected, and actually in reality, I knew that corporation was not paying me exactly what the white men were getting, but I felt like that I would have been within 10% of their salaries. I had no idea that I was so far apart from what they were earning. No wonder they could afford all those toys, as I called it, they had, the motorcycles, the trucks, the horses. I couldn't afford any of that. I was struggling to support my family and educate my children. They would have had a better quality education. My son would probably have a law degree, but he worked a job and went to school to get the 2 degrees he got. So did my daughter. They've done well, but they could have done better, and it could have been easier for us all. But when I learned, and halfway through that night, it suddenly hit me. My retirement is based on what I'm earning. My contributory retirement was a percentage of my salary matched by a percentage from Goodyear. My 401k, I signed up for 10% of my earnings. Goodyear would match it with 6% stock. And back in those days, the stock was running somewhere between $80 and $90 per share. That was a lot of money. But it was really breathtaking to think, right there on the spot, how much money I had just lost in my retirements. And then I thought, Social Security, when I signed up in 2 years for Social Security, that also is based on what I'm earning. I got home the next morning and I told my husband what I had learned and how much less I made. I said, I do need to go file a charge for the Equal Employment Council Commission in Birmingham, unless you object too strongly. Because I can tell you now, I know that it will take a minimum of 8 years to get through this once I start it, and I intend to stay with it. He said, what time would you like to leave? He supported me from the time I started. We did discuss it with the 2 children because they're out on their own, they have their own families. We didn't discuss it with them until it got further into the case. A few months later, the Equal Employment Commission called and said, you've got one of the best cases we've ever seen come across our desk. You may want to think about getting your own attorney and carry this case to the court system because we think you can do that quicker by doing it that way. Tell your attorney when you get one, if you decide to do that, to contact us. You've got the right to sue. I found an attorney in Birmingham, Alabama, John Goldfarb, pro bono, because you see, I was one of those employees that lived paycheck to paycheck. I didn't have the big bucks that it would take to go up against a large major corporation with a lot of money. He took my case pro bono, and he would have gotten 50% of whatever I was awarded. We didn't get to federal court, though, until 2003. A case like this is extremely hard to prove. It's extremely difficult to get into court. But we got there in 2003, and we got over another hurdle. Excuse me. But we also had a jury trial. I had 7 jurors, different ages, men and women. And when the jury deliberated after a week of testimony, they came back with a verdict in favor of the equal pay for $3.8 million. Now I've been told by the lawyer, no matter what the foreman says, don't make any facial expressions. If it's good, don't stand up and shout. If it's bad, don't moan and groan and cry. Just be very straightforward, look at the ball, no expression.